possible.
Thank you, Your Honor. We make choices every day. Some of those choices we make are small choices, whether we hit the snooze button again, what we have for breakfast, what route we take to work. And some of those choices we make are bigger choices. They have bigger impacts. They affect other people. We're here today because of the choices the defendant made, the choice he made to not abide by a valid court order and to go over to his ex-girlfriend and child of his mother's home in violation of that order. You're going to hear about the relationship the defendant had with Deatra Moore. Deatra Moore and the defendant have a child together. You're going to hear that it's been a complicated, complex relationship. You're going to hear that back in October of 2015, Ms. Moore got an order, a protection order against the defendant, and that that order was still in effect on August 23rd, 2016, when the defendant showed up at her home. You're also going to hear about the fact that these are two people that had a child custody dispute. And that it was an ongoing dispute. It was fluid. Things were changing. You're going to hear from Deatra Moore. And Deatra Moore is going to tell you that on August 23rd of 2016, in the middle of the night, she was home alone in her bed. She heard a noise in her bedroom, and she woke up, and she saw the defendant. You're going to hear that the defendant brought out an extremely large dildo and a butt plug. And you're going to hear that Ms. Moore allowed him to be there for a few hours. She didn't know what to do. She didn't feel comfortable calling the police with him there. And that eventually he left. It was the middle of the night. She went to sleep. She had to work the next day. She got up for work. She went to work. When she was done with work that day, she decided to call the police. She decided to enforce this order that she had against the defendant. And you're going to hear that following the call she made to police, an officer from the Vancouver Police Department showed up to speak with her. And that officer is Officer Dale Barnett. You're going to hear from him the observations that he made about Ms. Moore when he spoke to her. You're going to hear about the fact that he observed and took photos of the dildo and butt plug that the defendant left with Ms. Moore. And you're going to hear about the fact that he confirmed that there was this valid order in place that prevented the defendant from contacting Ms. Moore. Once you've heard all of the evidence in this case, the state's going to ask you to listen. Ask you to listen to the fact that there was a no contact order. Ask you to listen to what Ms. Moore had to say. Ask you to listen even though the defendant didn't that day on August 23rd of 2016. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bogart.
Certainly, Your Honor. Choices. The government just chose to not tell you everything you're going to hear. That's the father of the little girl. Up until June 10th of 2016, he and Deatra Moore shared custody about 50-50. Sometimes a little more for one way, sometimes a little less for the other. But they were working together. On June 10th, he sought and received an emergency custody order. On June 20th, that order was contested by Ms. Moore. On June 20th, the court entered an order as follows.
Objection.
Overruled.
Order.
Emergency custody, emergency circumstances is defined by an Oregon statute. That's That's Ms. Moore's initial. You're going to see that. Existed at the time petitioner father applied for emergency custody of their daughter, Anaya Destiny Stanfill L. When the court issued the emergency custody order on June 10th, 2016, the minor child was in immediate danger of the respondent mother's care. So for this little girl's life, she'd been splitting time about 50-50. He had to go to court. The court entered the order. The court confirmed the order. And a short time later, she makes a 911 call. Ladies and gentlemen, make no mistake. We are not here because of the choices he made. We are here because of the choices the government made. They made a choice not to conduct any investigation. You did not hear about fingerprint evidence. The Atra, I anticipate, will testify that Lawrence has never been in her bedroom. There are no fingerprints. You are not going to hear about any neighbors. She wrote a long statement. She said that she screamed loudly. Nobody went and knocked on the neighbor's door. You're not going to hear from her other daughter, who's 16 or 17. You're not going to hear about DNA evidence. You are going to hear a case that is nothing more than an allegation. That allegation was made, according to the government, about 12 or 13 hours after the incident allegedly occurred. Ms. Moore still gets time with her child. That time is supervised by Ms. Moore's mother. Ms. Moore, according to her story, got up. She didn't call the police right away. According to her story, she wakes up in the middle of the night, somebody's standing over her, happens for a couple hours, and then she just goes back to bed. Then she gets up a couple hours later, goes to work. When she gets off work, she talks to her mom, the child's supervisor. And it's at that point she decides to call law enforcement. Officer Barnett responds. He has Lawrence's address, phone number. They never give the guy a call. They never let him know that these allegations are out there. They never call to get his side of the story. They arrest him in December. He's in a final over at Portland State University. Officer Barnett referred the case to the Domestic Violence Prosecution Center. They got detectives. You're going to hear from at least one of them. Detectives are officers who have more resources. They got the case right away. They never called Mr. Stanfill up. They never got his side of the story. He was at home asleep with his little girl. Where were you 4.5 months ago or 4 months ago? Or was that?
Objection, argumentative.
Sustained.
He never was given the opportunity. I never asked him a question. And they never did any investigation. There's no fingerprint evidence. There's no DNA evidence. There's no corroboration. All there is a mother who had just been subject to an emergency custody order because of whatever it was that happened. And ladies and gentlemen, she told Officer Barnett that she was getting ready to go speak with an attorney. That's the case. They didn't tell you all that stuff. We are here because they made the choice to not do an investigation.
Objection.
Basis. Sustained.
Correct. They didn't do an investigation, and they chose to file the charges. That's why we're here.
Counsel, your first witness. But before we do that, we'll get the notebooks handed out. Gene, can you have the jury go back into the jury room for one moment? I have a malfunction on my computer.
Okay.
Thank you. Madam J.A., can you come out 1 second? Thank you. Hold on 1 second, let me make sure I get on the screen here.
It's Michelle. I'm in the Judge Gonzalez's courtroom, and his screen flipped upside down. And I know there's a. What do you do to get it back? Is it like, I know it's something simple. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, the whole thing. Yeah. Something you can do as well. whole view is upside down. What do you do to remedy that, to get it to flip back? You know, like, yeah. Am I making sense? It's not... The whole view is upside down, and I know that there's something easy you can do, like control something, something to flip it back around. I remember that Chris that used to work with us, he used to go up to our computers and turn them upside down as a joke. So when you logged on, everything was upside down, and then there was something easy you could do to flip it around, and I just don't remember what that is.
I think I found it.
It's something so simple.
It's just weird using the mouse opposite.
It's all upset. Okay, what's
it.
The...
No, I got it.
She got it? Oh, okay, she got it. Okay, thank you. What's that? Department 4.
Okay.
Hang on, are you still going to...